dragging on. So, sometimes in life there are things that you find something and you're like, how did I not know about this sooner? How is this just now being a part of my life? And it wasn't that many years ago that I felt like for the first time I discovered sour cream. And I was like, oh dang, this is really good. It gets a response either way. Sour cream, you have opinions. That's good. Recently, you know, just crack open a bag of tortilla chips and just, you know, boom, just sour cream. You don't need anything but sour cream. I was like, tortilla chips and sour cream, like they were made to go together. And at one point you didn't know that. And you found out and you're like, oh my goodness. You know, there was probably a first when somebody put syrup on pancakes for the first time. And maybe a few of you don't like that, and that's okay. You can be different. But pancakes and syrup, that's just kind of a standard thing, right? Peanut butter and jelly. There was a time when somebody was just like, I don't know, let's give this a try. And it turned out to be, you know, every kid's school, packed lunch, best friend. Right? You know, just throw some bread and peanut butter and jelly in there, and you got lunch. You'll be fine. And really, you can live pretty cheap if that's what you just decide to eat for a while. So, you know, there you go, a little money saving tip for you. I'm curious. There are some things that some people feel like this is a great match. Okay, like peanut butter and chocolate, you cannot argue against that. That is a gift from God, okay? But there are some things that you guys like to put together and you're like, I don't know. Do you have any examples? Ketchup on macaroni and cheese?
Cottage cheese and
apple sauce? Cottage cheese and apple sauce? Chocolate milk and what? Sour cream and onion Pringles. But do you dip them in there? No, it's just awful. All right, Abby?
Ice cream and french fries.
That's kind of the thing if you go to Wendy's, right? You gotta do that. You help with Josh?
Peanut butter
and hot sauce.
Peanut butter and
hot sauce. I don't know, if you go to Parsons, you can get peanut butter on a hamburger. That's
all right. Peanut butter and Oreos.
Peanut butter and Oreos.
Yes.
That's a good
one. Okay.
So some things you're like, I don't know if that really goes together. I don't know. And then you try it and you're just like, yes, that works. And so what we're doing tonight, what we did last week, what we're going to do next week, guys, is we're taking the question of how to find God's will for your life. And we're taking the story that many people learn as a child, that is a cultural cliche, David versus Goliath, and we're putting them together. And we're finding out that, hey, this tastes pretty good together. All right? So I'm excited tonight to continue sharing with you guys out of the story of David and Goliath and wrestling with some concepts here that I think really will help you to understand God's will for your life. And who doesn't want to know that? All right? That's a question that we would all love to have the answer to. And so let's go ahead and open your Bible to 1 Samuel chapter 17. That's where the story happens. And I recapped the story last week, just built up to, you know, David, he's the youngest of 8 brothers. He's been anointed to be the king, but right now he's not the king. And he's also a pretty skilled musician. So he's become employed in the service of King Saul, who's currently the king of Israel. And when sometimes there's a demon that would come and bother Saul, and so David would come play his harp, and the demon would leave. All right. And David was also an armor bearer for King Saul. And so he's kind of got this relationship, but he still has to go back sometimes to take care of the sheep because he's still the youngest, and he still is kind of a low man on the totem pole, even though he's going to be king. And so he comes, and as he comes, his dad, the Philistines and the Israelites are not really fighting. They're thinking about it, though. Like, they are lined up in all their gear. They're dressed up, you know. And there's that line in Braveheart where he says, you know, we didn't get all dressed up for nothing. They're still trying to decide. Maybe they did. They're not sure. Right? So they're gathered on 2 different hills. There's a valley down in here. And every day, Goliath comes down from the Philistine army. And he shouts defiant words to them. And he says, send me a champion. Send me a champion. Let's fight. And if I defeat your champion, you become our slaves. And if you defeat me, then we'll become your slaves. And this goes on for 40 days. And the Israelites are terrified. Saul's terrified. Saul has to offer, he has to try to bribe somebody. He says, you know, if you'll go fight, you can marry my daughter. I'll give you great riches. Your family will never pay taxes again. And nobody will do it. And so one day, of course, David's father wants to know how things are going, wants to know how David's brothers are there in the army, not fighting. And so Jesse wants to know how they're doing, so he sends them there with some gifts, and David gets there, and about the time that he shows up, Goliath shows up again, and he's shouting his blasphemies to her, his blasphemies about God and God's people. And so David's like, hey, how come nobody does anything about this? And David asks him questions, and as David is kind of interrogating the people, Saul finds out about it. And so they bring David before Saul. And what we looked at last week was the fact that David had faith to go and fight Goliath. David had faith to do something big for God because he had been faithful in smaller things. You know, just killing lions and bears. I mean, that's all. Just little stuff. And now he thinks he can handle the giant because God will be with him. And so we're going to continue that story. I'm going to reread what we read last week. I'm going to pick up actually in verse 31 when David's like, now hold on a minute. What's going to be done for this guy? What's going to happen? He's going to marry he's going to like be the king's son-in-law. And this, wow, okay. And so picking up the story in 1 Samuel 17, verse 31. This is what David said was overheard and reported to Saul. And Saul's the king, Saul sent for him. David said to Saul, let no one lose heart on account of this Philistine. Your servant will go and fight him. And Saul replied, you're not able to go against this Philistine and fight him. You're only a boy. He has been a fighting man from his youth. But David said to Saul, your servant has been keeping his father's sheep. When a lion or bear came and carried off a sheep from the flock, I went after it, struck it, and rescued the sheep from its mouth. And when it turned on me, I seized it by its hair. I struck it and killed it. Your servant has killed both the lion and the bear. This uncircumcised Philistine will be like one of them because he has defied the armies of the living God. The Lord who delivered me from the paw of the lion and the paw of the bear will deliver me from the paw of this Philistine. And Saul said to David, go and the Lord be with you. So David, and again, this is what I challenged you guys with last week. Like, what's God's will for my life? To be faithful where you are. That there are lessons that David learned in the wilderness. There are lessons that David learned in just the everyday humdrum lousiness of being a shepherd. And there are things that you can learn now that you won't be able to learn any other time. There are things in your life right now that God wants to teach you that later on, it's going to be way harder for you to learn. I don't know, just last week when I was thinking about this, it really hit me, just that concept of, you know, when David wrote the psalm and he said, the heavens declare the glories of God, even, you know, day and night, at night, the glory of God pours forth. And just like, what a blessing God gave to David, that David had to spend so many nights outside because he was a shepherd. And how much time David had to just ponder the glory of God. How much time he had to just praise God, to pour his heart out to God. Not many people would sign up for that, but that was a blessing that was in David's life. And I'm telling you, there are blessings right now. There are opportunities you have right now. Sometimes we're so eager for something else, whether it's, I just want to be done with college, I just want to start my career, I just want to find Mr. Wright or Mrs. Wright or whatever other thing it is, and we're not available to what God wants to teach us right now. But David didn't suffer from that. David was faithful, and so God used where he was to prepare him. So his faith was so impressive that Saul changes his tune. And just a few minutes ago, Saul had said, no way. And now Saul's like, okay, David, go right ahead. Okay. So I'm just recapping the story there. That was last week. All right. So this is our passage for tonight. We have these three verses. It says, then Saul dressed David in his own tunic. He put a coat of armor on him and a bronze helmet on his head. David fastened on his sword over the tunic and tried walking around because he was not used to them. I cannot go in these, he said to Saul, because I'm not used to them. So he took them off. Then he took his staff in his hand. He chose 5 smooth stones from the stream, put them in the pouch of his shepherd's bag, and with his sling in his hand, approached the Philistine. Okay. So Saul says here, I've got some armor for you to wear. Put this on. And David says no. Okay. Now, And maybe, I don't know, I guess just as I was reading just now, I'm like, maybe he's not actually wearing Saul's armor. I'm not actually sure. Oh, no, he does say his own tunic. Yeah, okay. I missed that there. Right. So Saul's like, here, wear my armor. David, if you're going to go to battle, you need to look like a warrior. You need to wear my armor. Now, why would he do that? Okay, why do that? Okay, now, guys, we're going to get into this. This is part of what I want to share with you tonight. Why? How do you find God's will for your life? Okay, because David is walking in faith. David is walking, stepping into the will of God. And Saul comes along with a different plan. And Saul says to him, here, wear my armor. And I think it sounds a lot like that phrase, you know, well, this is how we've always done it. You know, you decide you want to try something. You decide you want to step out in faith. And somebody else comes along and says, oh, no. You should do it this way. All right? This is how we've always done it. This is how it's always been done. I think that we get trapped in this place. I think churches get trapped in this place. I think ministries do. I think, you know, when we sit down, if we were to gather all of our student leaders and say, you know, we want to plan some activities. We want to plan some outreach events. How are we going to reach the campus? A lot of times, one of the first questions we want to ask is, well, what did we do last year? You know, and it's like, we get caught in a box so quickly. This is how it's always been done. And so you think about it, well, is there any other way to defeat a great warrior but to go fight him with your sword and your shield and your armor, right? I mean, that's just how it's done, okay? But this is cool, okay? God is in the business of creatively doing things. God is in the business of doing things in new ways. I remember having this pointed out to me one time that, you know, when the Israelites, let's rewind back a little bit in Israel's history. After they leave the land of Egypt and they wander in the desert for 40 years because they disobeyed God. And then they finally are going to start taking the promised land. So they have this guy named Joshua. Joshua's like the general of the army. He's Moses' successor. And they're going to go take the promised land. And so they come in and there are these walled cities. There are these great walled cities. And before, 40 years before, the earlier generation, they were so afraid of the people, they were afraid of the walled cities, they didn't trust God. So they come in, and their first major battle is this city called Jericho, all right? And if David and Goliath is a pretty well-known Bible story, I think like Joshua and the Battle of Jericho has got to be up there too. Like, you don't have to have a church background to maybe have heard of these things before, okay? Do you know the battle strategy for defeating Jericho? Who knows what it was? Who can just tell me? What do they do? Jeremiah.
Walk in circles and play trumpets.
Yeah. Walk around the walls and play your trumpets. I mean, there's a 7 days thing involved. But yeah, that's basically what they did. Walk around, they played their trumpets, and I think they shouted, you know.
Yeah.
Yes, we need some practice before we're going to take down the city. And it worked. It was a really effective strategy, okay? And you know how many times they employed that again? None. It's not because they never came to another walled city. In fact, the very next battle they find, the city of Ai, it was certainly not as big as Jericho, but I was reading some about this, and that even archaeologists have discovered, like there were sections of the wall at Ai that were 12 feet wide. It's like, well, God, why don't we just march around the city again? We know that works. And God's like, no, this time we're going to set an ambush. This time some of you, just a small number of you, are going to come up toward Perverse City while the rest of you hide behind that hill over there. And all the army's going to come out. And when they do, boom, you're going to win that way. And you're just like, what? Oh. And God's like, I got all kinds of things I want to do. I don't want you to get caught in this box of doing things the same way every time. How about this? Imagine you're following Jesus, which would be really awesome. And you're like a healing apprentice. You want to know how to heal blind people. So you watch Jesus, okay? And maybe you're just kind of watching from a distance. You're not really sure. But anyway, so you're following Jesus around. You kind of observe. And you see that Jesus, a lot of times when Jesus heals someone, he would touch their eyes. All right? He'd touch their eyes and he'd heal them. And their blindness would be removed. Their sight would be restored. And then one time, Jesus spits on a guy's eyes and then touches them. That's really weird. And then one time he spits on the ground and he makes mud and he puts the mud on the guy's eyes and he's not healed yet. He's not healed until he goes and washes the mud off. And then one time Jesus just says to a guy, be healed, and he can see. Now, I don't know about you, but I would be confused. Like, well, which way is it? And Jesus says, I got so many ways. Let me show you all the different ways that I can work. And so I think that's really cool, guys. I think that's really fun. I think God desires for us to walk with Him, not simply follow a formula. And that might be a little frustrating at times because we would rather have a guaranteed system that I do steps A, B, and C. It's, you know, I'd like it to be like math. You know, as long as you follow the steps or cooking, right? I mean, as long as you follow the recipe, you know what you're going to get on the other side. And God's like, no, that's not really what it looks like to follow me. All right, I want you to hear my voice, I want you to walk by the Spirit, and I want to use your uniqueness to accomplish my will. So I think one reason, why would we want to wear Saul's armor? Why would Saul want David to wear it? Well, how else are you going to do it? Like, this is the way it works. But we're going to find out it's not the only way that it works. Okay, in fact, it's not working this way right now, because Saul's armor is not doing anything. So the first thing, why would David be compelled to wear Saul's armor? Because that's how it's always been done. The second reason why? Because that's how Saul would do it. Now, I made this suggestion last week that, you know, when Goliath challenges the people of God and says, send out your champion, I believe that Saul is the champion of Israel. And if I'm wrong, that's not, like, theologically that important. But Saul is not going to go fight Goliath. Saul is going to sit on the bench and watch. But he sure knows how you should do it. Oh, man. You know a few people like that? Like, I'm not going to get in the trenches with you, but I will tell you how it ought to be done. And, yay for those people. Right? And now, I'm not saying that we can't take the advice from other people or learn from other people's examples, guys, but we really are all gifted differently. And this is what I'm trying to encourage you with tonight, is that you don't have to be just like Saul. David didn't have to be like Saul. It was far more important that David knew God, and that David had faith in God, and David was uniquely designed by God. And David had some skills and gifts that maybe nobody would have pegged David as a giant killer, because he was really good with a sling. But that's what he knew. And God used him in a mighty way. And so maybe that is how Saul would do it, but you don't have to do it just like Saul would do it. Because, guys, we have different history, we have different experiences, we have different skills, we have different gifts, we have different wounds, we have different hurts, we have all these different things. And God doesn't just waste those things. God uses those things to equip us and to use us to accomplish his purpose. And I do think, guys, we have to be careful because you know, sometimes in our efforts to make disciples, we want people to do things just like we do. And there are some things that we need to do, but there's different ways to do them. You know, it is important for you to share the gospel. Okay? And you need to figure out how does that become a part of your life. But not all of us are the same. Some of us are much better at walking up to strangers and starting conversations and sharing Jesus with them. You read through the Gospels, it's really interesting. All of the different evangelistic styles, even that the disciples have, but they don't all do it the same. And that's okay, because they're different. It's important to pray, but you don't have to pray the exact same way that I do. You don't have to pray the exact same way that Jeremiah does, okay? We're different. I do hope, what were you saying? You should come to 27 this weekend, all right? It'll be really good for your prayer life. If you want to have an effective prayer life, if you want to just spend some time with God, you want to grow in prayer, I think it would be really helpful for you. I'm excited about it. Okay, it's important to read the Bible. I mean, it's kind of like, I've said this before, that's kind of like exercising. I mean, there's so many exercise plans that will work if you do it. Spending time in the Word, there's a lot of different ways you can approach the Bible. There's a lot of different ways you can digest the Bible. Pick one that you'll do. I hear that about evangelism a lot. The best style of evangelism is the one that you will do. All right, so you don't have to do what Saul, you don't have to do it the way Saul would do it. All right, and David's going to accomplish the same task. He's going to fight the giant, but he's going to do it in a different way. And that's okay. That's okay, guys. I'm trying to tell you tonight, it's okay for you to be different. It's okay for you to be the way God made you to be. Okay? So David's response, right? David says, I mean, think about this for a second. The king, here's the king of Israel, And he says, here's what you need to do. And David's like, I don't think so. Like it just historically, it's never a great thing to just tell the king no. No, I mean, thanks for the advice. Thanks, but no thanks. And yet that's what he says. He says, no, I'm not going to do it your way. He says, because this isn't me. This is you. This is not the way God has designed me. Okay, this is, I know how God has developed me and how God has worked in me. And so I'm going to go with what I know. I'm going to go with how God has equipped me. Okay, so David's willing to say no to Saul. I'm not going to do that the way you want me to. I'm going to do it the way God designed me to do it. And David, you guys know, look, you can be pretty argumentative when you say, no, I'm not going to do it your way. Like, that's not what David's doing. That's not David's attitude. David said, like, I'm going to be faithful to what God's calling me to do. I'm going to be faithful to what God's designed me. And so thinking about David's response versus our response, you know, why is this so hard for us? Why is it hard for me to embrace the way God's designed me, be willing to be different, be willing to step out in faith rather than to conform, rather than to give into pressure, rather than to do what everybody else says I ought to do, even though maybe they're not even going to do it, okay? So why is that? Why is it so hard for us, okay? Well, man, I mean, from a very, very early age, we want to be accepted, all right? We want to be approved of. And, I mean, I have an 18-year-old daughter, I have, I mean, three kids, but, you know, Megan's almost out of the house, and Allison's 12, so she's still in middle school, so they've all at least made it through middle school and watching these stages of life, and especially middle school, I don't know, maybe all of them, like, school's brutal, and just the pressure to conform, and if you're different, you know, you're weird, just kids can be so mean. And I'm guessing some of you experienced that. I experienced that. I experienced some bullying and some things like that. I didn't exactly fit in. And I remember my high school, I went to Sumner Academy in Kansas City, Kansas, and my high school was 8 through 12. So I remember in 8th grade, this whole new experience, I'm going to high school, and there's stupid things that you do to try to fit in, all right? I've never been particularly fashionable, and I own it to this point. I don't care anymore. I'm like, this is fine. If you don't like it, that's not my problem. But there was this thing that we did when I was in high school. We would, like, do this thing, right? I don't know if this was a, let's see, where you, you know, you, like, you got to tight roll the jeans.
Ooh.
And,
yeah, that's
and oh, man, I didn't even wear long socks. Isn't that weird? Have any of you guys done this before? You know? All the time. And, all right, and yeah. I'm just going to leave it. Right. I know, that's what we did. We did both of them. But I'm just going to leave it just because it's so weird. All right. Something else that was really popular when I was in high school in terms of how you dress is you would wear, you'd get like a collared long sleeve shirt. It could be a dress shirt or it could just be, probably was just a dress shirt. But you'd wear a turtleneck underneath it. I think there's actually a picture of me on Facebook. I remember that now. There's a picture. I'm sitting on the couch with my grandma, my grandpa, and in a turtleneck with a, you know, a collared shirt over it. Because I was just trying to fit in. That's what everybody else in the 8th grade wore. I don't know. I don't know why. And you know what? Here's what I discovered. It didn't take me very long to figure out that I just didn't fit in with the cool people. And eventually, in my 8th grade year, I just quit trying. Right? But there was so much pressure to fit in. And I wanted to fit in. I wanted to be approved. I wanted to be liked. And so I conformed to what those people wanted me to be. I wanted them to like me. And guys, there's so much freedom in Christ. When the more and more that we begin to find our identity and our acceptance, our approval in God's love for us, in the fact that because of what Christ did on the cross, when I trust in Him, when I become a follower of Jesus, I'm adopted into God's family, that the righteousness of Christ is mine, and I'm completely forgiven, and I'm completely loved, and I'm accepted by God. And so I don't have to be accepted by everybody else. And I love this verse in Acts chapter 4, verse 19. After Peter and John were told, you know, they were told by the religious authorities, you just stop telling people about Jesus. Cut it out. And they said, judge for yourselves whether it is right in God's sight to obey you rather than God. Other Galatians where Paul says, he says, if I were still trying to please people, I would not be a servant of Christ. And so we've got to break free from that. And David had such a love for God that he didn't get trapped in that. That he wanted to be accepted. He wanted to be approved of. He was able to move beyond that. Second thing, why is it hard for us to do this? Because guys, it's hard to step out in faith. It's safer. It's safer to just go with what you know. It's safer to go with what everybody says. It's safer to follow the established system. It's just not necessarily better. It's not necessarily wise. Our good friend Matt Meyer. All right, Matt is going to be here this weekend. Matt and Lexi, I didn't mean to promote that. Matt, Lexi, and Audrey, and Ted, they're all going to come this weekend. Some of you guys have never met them before, so you should come to 27 just so you can meet them. Great people. Matt was on staff here last year. But Matt is serving at campus ministry at KU now. And I tell you what, KU is just different than Northwest. It's the spiritual climate is not the same. It's a lot tougher place to labor. It's a lot darker place. It's not spiritually the same kind of a climate. And it would be easy to just say, well, I don't care. I'm just going to do exactly what we did at Northwest. I'm just going to trust the system. Instead of being willing to adapt, instead of being willing to try new things, instead of being willing to step out in faith, okay? It's easier to just do what you know. It's easier to just trust other people's wisdom. It's easier to say, well, I mean, I don't really know if this is right or not, but Andrew told me to do it, so I'm just going to do it. You know, this is what Saul wants me to do, and if it doesn't work out, then it's not my fault, it's Saul's fault. I'm not going to take any risks. And I talked about that last week. You know, that David was willing to take risks, obviously, because he's getting ready to go fight a giant. But he was a risk taker early in life, because whenever the sheep got taken away, he would go after him. And when the lion turns around, just grab him by the hair. Do you like that verse? I know, that's amazing. I mean, he says it like so matter of fact. Like, that's not even the coolest thing I ever did, you know. You just grab lions and kill them all the time. You know? What did you do today? You know? I killed a lion. That's what David does. So it's safer, guys. I know that. It's safer to do what everybody expects you to do. You can even kind of deflect the blame. You can blame somebody else rather than having faith, stepping out and trusting God, okay? And then finally, sometimes we don't do it any other way because we just don't know any other way. We couldn't say what David says, where David says, you know what, I'm going to go with what I know. I know that God works in my life in this way, so I'm going to trust God to continue to do that. We're like, I don't know. And part of that comes from what we talked about last week. You have to be faithful now. God wants you to learn now. Just like you're being equipped for a career, you should be getting equipped for serving God for the rest of your life. And how do you do that? How do I know? How do I begin to learn? Okay, so this is what we're going to spend the rest of our time on. Figuring this out. How can I embrace this reality to be who God made me to be? Okay? Okay, well, first of all, there's some things we have to recognize that we have the same end goal, but we don't get there necessarily the same way. We have the same goals, right? It's to know God. That is God's will for all of us. Second Peter 3:9 says that the Lord is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but all to come to repentance. Like, it's God's will for you to come to repentance. It's God's will for you to repent of your sins and trust in Jesus. Done. It's God's will for you to know Him, to know who He is, to know what He's like, to know His character, to know what He wants. All right. It's God's will for you to become like Jesus. In fact, I think God's far more concerned about your character becoming like Christ than He is about, I said this last week, than He is about even what job you have or who you date or where you live. Okay? And of course, it's God's will for all of us to be a part of making disciples of all nations. Okay? Those are the givens. But how do we do that? Okay, well, here's the thing. Their body has different parts with different functions. Now, if we could get a hold of this, this would be really helpful for us. Okay? In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, guys, the fact that we're not all the same, and that's a good thing. That's a good thing. That maybe Saul would want us all to do things exactly the same way. Maybe he would want us all to look just like him. But we're not. And that's by God's design. And that's wonderful, okay? In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, okay, in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, Paul gives this incredible analogy of the body of Christ to a physical body, right? And he says, starting in verse 14, he says, "Now the body is not made up of one part, but of many. If the foot should say, 'Because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body,' it would not, for that reason, cease to be a part of the body." You hear that? I mean, if you got to pick, would you rather be a hand or would you rather be a foot? There's some people who, like, feet really freak them out. All right? I don't know. Feet are probably more useful. I don't know. Useful is not the right word, but feet and hands, they're pretty important, both of them. But I know one of them is considered a little more on the key. This doesn't probably bother anybody. You may take my shoes off, my socks. You don't, okay? Part of that, I think what Paul is saying is, you know, if the foot says, "Oh, I'm not a hand," like some people, and we're going to get, I'm going to continue to explain this to you guys, but I think as we begin to understand or we wrestle with our giftedness, our uniqueness, the way God has designed us, we don't like it. We're like, "Well, but it'd be so much cooler to be a hand. Like, I don't want to be a foot." Okay? Well, let's keep going here. First of all, he says, "Well, that doesn't change anything. You're still a part of the body, even if you don't want to be." He says, "And if the ear should say, 'Because I'm not an eye, I don't belong to the body,' again." Maybe the eye seems cooler than the ear. All right? I would go with that. But that, for that reason, it would not cease to be part of the body. And if the whole body were an eye, where would the sense of hearing be? If the whole body were an ear, where would the sense of smell be? Paul's saying it would be ridiculous if the body parts got to pick where they want to rearrange themselves, and all of a sudden you're just like a giant eye. You know, you can see really, really well, but you can't go anywhere because you don't have any legs or any feet, or you just got legs with no feet, right? That's so weird, right? If the whole body were an eye, where would the sense of hearing be? Like, where would a lot of things be, right? If the whole body were an eye, you would just run. That's a horror movie. Okay. And if the whole body were an ear, where would the sense of smell be? Okay? And that's kind of silly, but he's saying, guys, this is ridiculous. Because this next verse says, "But in fact, God has arranged the parts of the body, every one of them, just as he wanted them to be." That the body parts are exactly where God wants them to be. And so, guys, we talk about this sometimes, that, you know, we are fearfully and wonderfully made, that we're all unique, we're all different, we're crafted differently, we've been shaped differently, and it's by God's design. And so if God has made you an ear, it's because that's what he wanted you to be. If God has made you a nose or a mouth or an elbow, that's what he wanted you to be. And that's good, because the body needs all of those things. And so, it's okay, guys, that we're not all great at everything. And we don't need to be great at everything. In fact, I think that's a modern myth. You know, this idea of like the well-rounded person. I've had listened to a lot of talks about leadership. I've learned a lot of things about leadership, read books on leadership. And once upon a time, and I think this works not just for leadership, but in terms of your part of the body of Christ. I think there was a trend in leadership for a long time to imagine leadership like a bucket. Like, your leadership potential is a bucket, but it's got holes in it. Okay, and those kind of represent your weaknesses. And so the way that you become a better leader is you have to shore up all your weaknesses, and everything that you're bad at, you have to become good at. And then I remember going to a leadership conference one time. There was a speaker there named Reggie McNeil. Reggie McNeil's written several books. And he said this 100 times, probably, and I memorized it. I Googled it, and it's everywhere. And he says, "My best shot at making my biggest contribution is getting better at what I'm already good at." My best shot at making my biggest contribution is getting better at what I'm already good at. Because can you walk on your hands? Maybe you can. I mean, is it possible? Somebody could. Maybe Nick can do it. I'm not going to put you on the spot. But theoretically, it's not possible. It's possible. But you're wasting your time. There's a way better way to do it. Your feet, your legs are always going to be better at walking than your hands and your arms. That's not what it was made to do. You know, we're kind of... All right. there's something that we tell kids sometimes. We tell people, you know, if you try hard enough, you can accomplish anything. Guys, I'm pretty sure that is not true. All right? I know it's late. I'm 40 years old, but I'm pretty confident there's no amount of effort that ever could have ended up in an NBA career for me. Okay? Or any sport, you know. Never. You know, I can pour a lot of effort. I'm one of those people who makes a joyful noise unto the Lord, right? Like, I don't have much musical ability. I'm amazed because a couple of my kids have skills in music, and I don't know. Karen and I, we're not musical, so somewhere higher up in the gene pool, it filtered, skipped, and went to them, and that's great, okay? But I'm sure that if some of you guys, maybe you give voice lessons or you go to voice lessons, maybe I could go with you to those, and over time, maybe I could be okay. No, Ann's saying I couldn't. I'm just saying. I can try, so I can try really, really hard, and maybe I could reach my potential. Maybe my potential's not very high, okay? But I put a lot of effort into becoming the best singer I could be. And guys, that would be a complete waste of my time. Because that's not what God designed me to be, all right? I know you guys don't all know Tyler Walker, but I'll never forget the first time I heard Tyler Walker sing. Man, I knew he was a good guitar player, but I was in that other room, and I know you guys don't all know Tyler, but anyway, he's a friend of mine. He goes to my church. He used to be on staff here, and he led worship for several years for us. But I was sitting in that other room, and he started singing this song by 10th Avenue North, I think, and he was singing it. And I thought that they were just, or maybe it was a Leland song. Actually, I take that back. I think it was a song by Leland. But it was Tears of the Saints. And I thought they were just playing it on the system. And I looked in here and he was singing. And I was like, oh my goodness, that's Tyler. It's like, wow. He is such a gifted musician. I mean, he recorded some music. And it's just incredible talent that he has. That's from God. Okay, that's a God-given gift. And gee, I wonder if that's something that God wants to have as a part of his life. And I will never, no matter how much I try, I'll never be able to do what he can do. So that's like me saying, you know, well, I'm not an eye. I guess maybe I'm not a mouth. You know, I'm not a singing mouth. You know, I think maybe I am a mouth. But it's not the same kind of mouth. I do believe that God's equipped me to teach and preach and understand his word. And that's what I should spend my time developing. That's the way I can make my best contribution to the body of Christ. And guys, it used to kill me that I'm not a great evangelist, that I'm not a great personal evangelist. And I told you guys a little bit that last week. That how did I learn that? Well, I did some of that. I'll talk to plenty of strangers about Jesus, but that's not my gift. All right, and I've probably had as many train wrecks as I've had successes in that, and that's okay. Who knows? Maybe God still used those things. But I used to feel really bad about that. I feel like I was a bad Christian because I wasn't great at all of these things. And sometimes we take a thing and we hold it up and we're like, oh, well, that's the thing I want to be great at. I'm just great at this thing. This is stupid. Or we say, I'm not great at anything. I'm not good at anything. I don't have a gift. Well, we can spend more time in 1 Corinthians to see that the Spirit of God has gifted every believer. Every one of us has gifts, okay? But we're different. We have different functions, all right? And in no way should our gifting, because maybe you have a cool gift, you know, maybe you could be like Tyler. When you sing, somebody like me is just like, whoa, that was amazing. All right, in 1 Corinthians chapter 4, Paul writes these words. He says, who makes you different from anyone else? Well, what's the answer to that? Who makes you different? God does, right? He says, who makes you different from anyone else? What do you have that you did not receive? And if you did receive it, why do you boast as though you did not? You know, if you happen to be a hand or an eye or one of those parts of the body that other people wish they could be, you are only that by the grace of God. And there is no room for boasting. There's no room for pride. God is the one who gave you that gift, and it's all to be used for his glory, okay? And so David is fighting for the glory of God, and we'll see that as we get into the rest of the story next week. So how do you determine your role? How do you figure out what part of the body you are, okay? All right. I thought maybe I should, in hindsight, maybe I should have had a handout for you or something. All right, these are two tools, okay? And these are very different tools. They do different things, but they're not 100% different, all right? You could use this as a screwdriver, okay? And you know, depending on the screw, you might actually like chip off the tip or something like that. Right? But I'm sure you guys, there are lots of tools that you can use as a screwdriver, right? And none of them are as effective as an actual screwdriver, right? You could use this as a putty knife. You could use this as a paint scraper, all right? Man, if you were scraping a house, scraping a house takes a long time. This would take you forever, okay? But you can do it. I bet there's been a time in your life, some of you do, where you're like, I mean, who needs a hammer, right? I can cut the back of this thing. You know, or maybe you grabbed like a glass jar and you were thinking, and then you shattered it in your hand, right? These tools have different purposes, okay? And because of that, they have a different design. They look different. And if I thought about this, I just couldn't come up with any really, really weird tools where we could be like, I don't know what this is. Let's just look at it and see if we can figure out what it might be based on its shape, based on its design. Because tools are designed very specifically, all right? Even this microphone, why is it made like this? I mean, it's designed this way so it's easy to be held in your hand. Why isn't this part like 2 feet long? Because it doesn't need to be. Because it would get in the way, because it would be silly. It's optimized for what it's supposed to be used for, right? I mean, all these things. The reason the guitar is designed that way, there's a reason that is shapes the way the sound comes out of it. It's not just, doesn't that look cool? Okay? What I'm saying is, you can look at your shape. You can look at the way God has made you and start to understand your purpose. Okay? So let me start out with this. And if you were taking notes, here's some questions just to ask yourself. Like, what are you good at? What are some things that just come naturally to you? Because, you know, sometimes we try things and we find out, we're like, nope, that's not for me. And I guess I should pause here and just say at this point, I probably have this in my notes somewhere, that I'm not saying that you always get to do the things that you like or you always get to do the things that you're good at. Okay? There is just something called obedience. You, even if your gift is evangelism, you need to effort and labor to share Jesus with people. You know, maybe you don't have the gift of giving, but you still need to give. Maybe you don't have the gift of showing mercy, but you still need to be laboring to be a merciful person. But there are some people who, man, you know, there's some people who, they just give really good advice. Like, we'd all kind of like to give good advice, and we all offer our advice, and some people are just really good at it. Some people, they don't even try to give people advice, but people come to them. Why? Because that's part of the way God has gifted them. You know, what are the things that you do and you see success? Right? That's one way to tell what your shape is. What is something that you enjoy doing? Because by and large, maybe we've gotten this idea that, you know, serving God is going to make us miserable. And I already said this, that there's going to be some things that you just have to do because you're just being obedient to God. But by and large, I mean, I don't know, being a little silly here, but I think the screwdriver enjoys screwing things in. I think it probably does not enjoy being used as a hammer. Okay? When you're doing what God made you to do, there is a level of joy that comes from it. I'll tell you guys, one of my favorite things to do in the whole world is to get up and teach the Bible. And I know a lot of you, I remember a Jerry Seinfeld skit one time when where he said, the number one fear in America, the number one fear is public speaking. The number two fear is death. He said, so at a funeral, people would rather be in the casket than delivering the eulogy. Okay. Oh, this does not scare me. Alright? I'm not saying I never get nervous, but like, I love this. I love it. I love to preach God's word. I love to teach God's word. I love to study God's word. Because that's part of the way God designed me. And guys, people who go to Africa to serve God. We kind of think maybe, well, if I really get surrendered to God, if I get serious, God's going to make me, you know, go overseas and do some horrible thing. People who go want to go. They think it sounds like a good idea. My friends who do college ministry, they love it. I have a friend who does youth ministry, and I'm not always sure about his sanity. I don't think you could pay me enough money to be a youth pastor. But he loves it. And it's like, wow. And you know, sometimes we think that. We think, you know, there's things that there's things that you think nobody would enjoy this. And then you meet that person. I'll never forget Robin Oldfield. I haven't met many people like this. She loved cleaning toilets. We always had something for her to do. Okay? What is it you enjoy? What is it that you want to do for God? Okay? Another question. What problems do you see that you want to solve? And this is something, too, that just fascinates me about the way we're uniquely created, the way that we function. Guys, that because God has made you differently, you will see things that other people don't see. All right? And that is a window into understanding your unique gifting from God. One of the things about me, I'm an includer. I want people to belong. If you've ever played softball with me, and I was the captain of the team, I remember a guy one time saying he would never play again because I'm not competitive enough. Some of you guys think that's not even true, okay? No, because when we played softball, I would make sure that everybody played. Everybody played the same amount. You didn't have to be Andrew McDonald to be the best guy on the team. You could hit, 400-foot bombs, Fastball inside.
I hit a bomb.
It doesn't matter. And so that's just me, though. I want people to be a part. I want people to be included. And so so I try to create environments where people can be included. And I've had some people want to not play softball with me anymore because I wasn't competitive enough for them. And that's fine. Some of you guys can't even imagine that. Just trust me. Trust me. Okay? It's true. And, man, it drives me crazy, guys. It kills me when I see people who aren't being included. And a lot of you guys, maybe you don't notice this. I'm just going to share this. This is going on video. I'm telling you guys this right now, all right? When real life is over, and you guys get into your groups of people, and you talk to one another, if there's a person standing over there in a corner that nobody's talking to them, I know. I noticed it. It drives me nuts. I'll go talk to them. Sometimes I'll try to get some of you guys to talk to them. And I don't think that some of you guys, I don't think it's that you don't care. But you just don't notice. Because that's not your gift. Okay? And that's okay, but if I come tell you, hey, then you're gonna, just be friendly. And so if you're new tonight and nobody talks to you, I'm sorry, you're gonna have to talk to me. Okay? I hope that doesn't happen. I hope we try to be friendly. We love people. But some people when my wife has the gift of mercy, and she just notices when people are hurting. And I don't always notice that. And, sometimes somebody's in this room and they get up and they walk out. And my first thought is, oh, they must have to go to the bathroom. And then I see Karen get up and follow them. I'm like, oh, no, they're not headed to the bathroom. They're having a really rough time. And she saw that and I didn't. What do you notice? What are the problems that you see? What do you feel burdened to do something about? That's a key to what God has designed you to do. All right. I think it's important that we recognize that. And guys, even just your friends, people who know you well, what do they think you're good at? What do they think you're passionate about? What are those things that you would stay up and talk about all hours into the night because you're so fired up about it? Man, that's a key into understanding God's design for you. But David was passionate about the glory of God. And that's why he did what he did in the first place. So last thing, figure it all out. Guys, just do something. Just start serving. Because if all you've done is just sit on the couch, even your best friends aren't going to know what you're good at. Like, I don't know. I mean, I guess you're going to sit on the couch. I don't know exactly how God would work through that. Maybe we should try something else. All right? So maybe you just need to go serve in the nursery. Some people love to do that. I appreciate those people. When we had small children, we served in the nursery. And we did that, I believe, until all of our children were done with diapers. And so when Allison was out of diapers, man, I was like, I am never going to the nursery again. I've never served in the nursery, and I would if they needed me to, but like, they're going to have to come find me and drag me in first, They'll find all of you first, and then no one else is there. I will do that, okay? I'm willing. That's not my thing. But I tried this. Go serve the nursery. Try join the E-team. Go visit a nursing home. Go pick up a service project. Come with us on spring break. Like, do some things. Try some stuff out. This is something that Karen and I talk about. Karen loves to bring this up all the time. The college, especially college ministry, it's like a laboratory. And some of you guys have had, you know, like a chemistry lab or something like that, and you go in there and they probably don't give you anything that can cause a major explosion, but you mix some stuff up and you kind of see what happens. And I think in college, it's time for you to try some stuff. Serve God in a variety of ways and see, what do you enjoy? What goes well? What doesn't go well? What do you love? What do you see like, man, I still remember, I read the first sermon I ever preached was 1 Thessalonians 5, it's either 17 or 19, I was getting confused, but it's the one that says, do not put out the Spirit's fire. Do not put out the Spirit's fire. That's the first sermon I ever preached. I remember sitting in the house on 1st and Walnut where Brian Lodge and I live, working on that sermon. And it just jumped off the page to me, and I couldn't write it down fast enough. And that happens to me all the time. God just gave that to me. Wow, I learned that in college. I had opportunities to lead and to serve here at the BSU, to try things out. So just do something. That's how you discover God's unique gifting for you. But guys, I guarantee you, God's will for you is to be you. You don't have to wear Saul's armor. And I'm so thankful that David would say, you know, I just don't think this is how God wants to use me. I'm going to do something else. Because we have this really cool story that we're going to finish up next week. And guys, I'm not saying this doesn't excuse you to be indulging your unique sinfulness. You know, well, I'm just an unhappy person. And people just have to put up with my unhappiness. No. All right, that's not what I'm talking about. Okay, I'm sure you. I probably didn't give you that disclaimer. You know that, right? We're not talking about your unique sins, and maybe you just are a sarcastic, mean person, and so you're like, well, it's just how God made me to be. It's not. Okay, the scripture also says to put to death whatever belongs to your sinful nature. Okay, so the sin needs to go, but your personality, your skills, your abilities, your gifts, your resources, God wants to use those for his glory, and that's what David did. And so I fully believe, guys, that he wants to do that in your life as well. And it's my prayer that you would understand that more and more. And I think that you begin to reflect on your life. You begin to think about what God's done. You pray about that. You talk to people who know you best. And you begin to unravel and understand God's will for your life. So let me pray for you. And give you a time just to pray, talk to God, to reflect. The worship team is going to lead us in a final song. And I just say, what a great opportunity we have. That God wants to use us, that God has made us specifically the way that we are for a purpose, because we're a unique part of the body of Christ. And so let's be faithful to do that. Let's pray. Lord, you're good. I love you. I thank you, God, for the privilege we have of being in the body. I thank you for all the parts. And I'm so thankful for my brothers and sisters who can do things that I can't do, who see things that I don't see, who understand things I don't understand. And God, I'm so thankful that not everybody in the body is just like me. Lord, I pray for my brothers and sisters that you would encourage them tonight, that you would speak to their hearts, that they would be able to evaluate themselves and their lives in the way that you uniquely equip them, the way that you're shaping them, the way that you want to work in their lives, and that they'd be faithful. They wouldn't give into fear. They wouldn't be afraid to step out and take risks. But God, they would have a bold faith, and they would try things for you, and then you would bless that for your glory, Lord. Amen.